Within a vast, mysterious universe, whose origin and future are incomprehensible to human minds, there spins a small planet that houses a variegated human family. Those of us concerned about the right to be variegated are determined to preserve the wall of separation between church and state and the freedoms ensured by the First Amendment to our Constitution, which begins, "Congress shall make no law regarding the establishment of religion." Food for Thought Productions is pleased to present a report from the Global Humanist Congress, which was held in Mexico City. Conveners of the Congress were Paul Kurtz, publisher of Free Inquiry magazine, the Academia del Humanismo of Mexico, and Spin Internet. Our special guests who attended the Congress are Dr. Gora Vijayam, Executive Director of the Atheist Center in Vijayawada, India, and Dr. Nirmal Mishra, Professor at Cal State University, Northridge, California. Our main topic was the Congress and its theme, Global Humanism in the Cybernetic Age. This was a reunion for the three discussants who had met previously at the Atheist World Conference in Vijayawada, India. They reminisced about their previous meeting and related matters. Here is Lee Baker, producer of this series, with our guests.
I asked my guests why cybernetics was chosen for this Congress.
Cyber age was picked up because of the communication and the interactive media that we have in order to promote humanism all over the world. Mm-hmm. And especially in response to similar approaches which are being used by the right-wing religious
They have
groups.
Terrific media outreach.
As you know, we have had a TV outreach project, the Atheist United group locally, and we've been on a number of stations locally, and lately we're going national with the Atheist Alliance, and we can't wait to go global.
We need to expand that aspect of our activities.
Certainly,
as
yes.
well. Right.
So that was the central theme of this conference.
Yes. And Dr. Gora, shall I call you Vijayam? Dr. Vijayam?
Dr. Vijayam. Yes.
Dr. Vijayam. And Gora is from your father's name.
Yes,
you're
please.
Named after your father.
Yes.
We're going to talk about him a little bit later. Mm-hmm. But tell us about your speech, because your speech was... You were one of the important speakers on the program. I noticed in the program in big letters. What did you tell them?
Yes, this is an important conference because there is always a quarrel between science and religion. But what is happening now is religion is absorbing many of the scientific instruments, and they are using
co-opting
and using the cyber age for their own benefit. It is the time for all the humanists, rationalists, and atheists to use the media effectively so that we can communicate with people much more effectively about our ideas.
Right.
Keeping that in view, the 13th World Conference of the Humanists concentrated on the cyber age, humanism mm-hmm. in the cyber age.
Mm-hmm.
And in this conference, we discussed various aspects. People came from all the continents.
And how many countries were represented?
All the five continents.
All the continents.
Of all the continents. And there was a good contingent from the United States also.
Mm-hmm.
And the emphasis was given on the developing world, mm-hmm. particularly the Middle East, South Asia.
Did you have people from the Asian countries too?
Yes, please.
Asian
from
countries
the Asian
too.
Countries, mainly from India, mm-hmm. Nepal, mm-hmm. Bangladesh. And we have people from other countries in Middle East.
What about the African nations?
Yeah, some of the African nations were represented
well.
There.
But they're struggling for democracy
yeah.
right now.
And even from Iran and mm-hmm. other places. Particularly, there was good contingent from South America.
Nirmal, you had a chance to meet with Dr. Taslima Nazreen. I've followed her saga in the media. What's happening with her now?
Dr. Taslima Nazreen is a medical doctor. She's also known as a writer in Bengali language. And the first novel...
And she's from Bangladesh.
She's from Bangladesh.
Yes.
And one of the first novels which she wrote was as a result of the aftermath of the destruction of a mosque in India. And in response to that, there were destruction of Hindu temples in Bangladesh. And her whole novel is related to this event and also the love relationship between a Hindu and a Muslim. And she was denounced right away as a result of that. And some of the comments that she made made the Muslim fundamentalist quite angry, and they issued a death warrant against her.
Death warrants.
Yes, and as a result of which, she had to escape from that, and she's left Bangladesh and went to Sweden as a refugee.
And here is Dr. Nasreen with Dr. Nihal Karim, head of the Humanist organization in Bangladesh.
Her residence is in Sweden.
Does she work there as a writer or as a doctor or?
No, neither of these, but I think she's trying to write again in Bengali. And she's also invited in many conferences, and she's making interaction with other right-minded, like-minded people.
Right. So she's now basically a political activist, is that right?
Political activist, civil rights and human rights and feminist. Mm-hmm. And she's in defense of all these rights. And she declared herself to be an atheist.
Yes.
And extraordinary person.
Nirmal, I know you have plans for Dr. Nasreen. What did you have in mind?
We would like to invite her to Northridge or to in the,
to the
Los
University.
Angeles area. Mm-hmm. And there are many people who have responded to me. And a group of Bangladeshis from Florida would also like to invite her. She has already visited the Harvard University. Mm-hmm. And the main theme of that is to propagate her ideas of secular humanism and against fundamentalism, religious
right.
fundamentalism.
What other fields, what other people
I think,
were represented?
By and large, I would say there were social workers, philosophers, and scientists were there, and activists of in different fields.
Political activists.
Students, political activists, and students were there.
Students.
Teachers,
mm-hmm.
professors,
mm-hmm.
and it was a good assembly of international
cross-section.
Cross-section from representing almost the whole world in a way.
We're so familiar here with the radical religious right, the radical Christian coalition and so forth here. Tell us a little bit about the fundamentalists in other parts of the world.
I think fundamentalism is nothing but the fear of religious people that they're losing ground. They want to cling on to the old ideas so that they will have control over the minds of the people.
Mm-hmm.
Fundamentalism is growing in all the religions because they're not looking forward, but they're looking backward.
Yes.
And backward, any kind of backwardness is a retrograde step. So all progressive-minded people must fight fundamentalism so that women could come up very well.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, the fundamentalists in the Muslim countries and the Eastern countries, what they are doing is they are suppressing women completely.
Mm-hmm.
That's a matter of grave concern.
Mm-hmm.
Half of the humanity has been suppressed in the name of fundamentalism and religion.
And all humanity is shortchanged.
Yes, yes.
As a result
And
of
in
that.
Fact, many of the liberals in the religion also do not like this kind of fundamentalism. So we have to make a common cause. The humanists, rationalists, atheists, freethinkers, and all progressive-minded people must make a common cause to fight fundamentalism so that humanity can progress into the 21st century.
Your mother was way ahead of her time.
I love the caption for this conference, Social Progress and Women.
Yes, please.
And she's saying no gender bias, all are human.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And this conference was at your Atheist Center in Vijayawada.
Yeah.
Now, I wonder how will these men who are so insistent of being holding women down, how are they going to be
convinced that they are limiting themselves. Now, I know I've met your wife, Nirmal, mm-hmm. and most people wouldn't realize that an Indian couple would have such an equality as you have, and she's a professional, and you're both teachers, mm-hmm. and you seem to have such a wonderful, pleasant life, both of you productive and respecting each other. Why are these men so insistent on holding women down? Why is that?
I guess probably it's a social historical kind of situation that for many years it has somehow generated a male-dominated society.
Nirmal, why don't you go out and missionary a little bit and let these men know that it's better this way?
Well, I think many people are doing that in India.
I think only a slave makes a tyrant. Similarly, the liberation of women must come from within. Women must stand up and say, we will not accept
That's
this
true.
Kind of secondary
you,
status.
You yes. just put your finger yeah. on a very big point right there.
So the slavery mm-hmm. continued it as long as slaves consider themselves as slaves.
Every
Similarly, year. Women's emancipation cannot come from outside. It's only a mental revolution.
Mm-hmm.
Women are bound mm-hmm. by social customs, by mental attitude. And mm-hmm. if the moment the mental attitude changes, a lot of change will come. In India also, we have a lot of change in the attitude of women because we have freedom to vote.
I like the way you were teaching young women how to sew. And when they graduated, they got their sewing machines to take home. So they were in business. Now, do you have connections with students in the universities in India?
Yes,
we want to do more of that here.
Yeah, we have connections with the universities. In fact, what our programs we do at this center, we work with the University of Health Sciences, we work with the universities, we work with the colleges, because in India, India is a nation of youngsters. 60% of our population is youngsters.
60%?
Yeah, mm-hmm. of the population.
Now our population is getting older.
Yeah, yeah. Our population is growing younger day
oh,
by
I
day.
See.
And that is why on the one side we propagate family planning
mm-hmm.
to control the surge of population. On the other side, to bring the youth into the mainstream of the national reconstruction.
Right.
That is why we are concentrating on the young people and mm-hmm. motivating them to take up social reform activities.
Dr. Vijayam, what we would like to know, or at least I would like to know from being here in America in an educational institution, is how exactly you approach the colleges and universities in order to promote your ideas and your goals.
How are you doing your campus outreach?
We adopt a multi-pronged approach. We go to the campuses and speak in the colleges and universities and high schools. That's one approach. Mm-hmm. Another one is we organize a number of programs. As the Thesis Center is there in Vijayawada for the last 50 years, we have excellent rapport with the government as well as the universities and colleges. Mm-hmm. So we organize the programs, we organize seminars, conferences, and also study camps.
You say you have study camps. How do those work?
Because they are like workshops. On yeah. specific problems, like the origin of the concept of God, what is the, how the concept of God came, and what is its relationship with human being mm-hmm. in the development. Similarly, atheism in
the,
many lands.
What the impact is on yeah. mm-hmm. people's lives.
Yeah. And similarly, how science and technology broadened mental horizons, and how mm-hmm. we can use effectively for social justice
mm-hmm.
and women's liberation.
Right.
We take up various aspects and break down into various ideas and discuss them threadbare. Mm-hmm. And this interests the young people very much.
Now, what about sex education? We have a big problem in this mm-hmm. country. The fundamentalists don't want to teach young people anything about sex, so they go and get into a great deal of trouble.
Mm-hmm. It's a very...
From ignorance.
Yeah, it's a very important topic. That's why this center is emphasizing on sex education. In fact, my brother, Dr. Samaram, who is an important person in the Ethics Center, he wrote already 100 books on various aspects of health.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote a 5-volume work on sex education.
Mm.
In fact, we call it sex science. With that caption, he wrote 5 volumes. And then he serialized them in the daily newspapers. The response is very good. In the developing countries, particularly in a country like India, unless we have sex education, we cannot control population.
In India, they would like sex education to be taught in the schools.
Right.
And also, there's no voucher system there, which you would like to have here, that if you're sending a child to parochial school, the government will pay for that. No, that is not true. That is basically...
That's a personal choice. You pay for it.
Yeah, it's a personal choice. You can send your child to any expensive school if you want to. But as far as the government is concerned, it has the total responsibility of educating the people.
Public education for everyone.
That is a fundamental difference I found out.
Do you get any opposition to family planning or abortion in India?
In India, abortion is legal.
It's legal.
And there is no resistance. In fact, many people are coming forward to learn family planning techniques.
I see.
And we have to move with the changing times.
Mm-hmm.
If we want to make people responsible for their actions, they must know what happens to their body.
Right.
And that is why family planning techniques are very much essential.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, we have hospitals in the villages where we do family planning operations. And we encourage people to have spacing between one child and another.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And we also encourage late marriages.
Mm-hmm.
If they postpone their marriages, there will be lesser population.
Mm-hmm.
That is why we encourage small family norm, one or two children.
We spoke of many things, and Gora stated his belief that we're heading for a post-religious world. But I wasn't so confident of that.
It may be unrealistic to believe that we'll ever have a post-religious world. There's probably always going to be those who need an escape from reality.
In the name of religion, in the name of emotional satisfaction, we are keeping them under suppression and oppression. So there must be complete freedom for the people. Both people are both rational and emotional, that we agree. And people are psychological in their approach. That's true. But at the same time, let them know the truth.
I think that we have to accept the fact that there's always going to be that need, just like the movies.
But one important thing, can we base our entire life on an unreal, imaginary other world?
Oh no, not the entire life. Absolutely not. But some people need that little sort of a relief once in a while.
Mm-hmm. If someone wants to live in a make-believe world for some time, it is their prerogative. But the truth is truth. The truth is there is no God. Truth is that God is human imagination.
Right.
So let people know that. And on that basis, if anyone wants to still live in illusion and delusion of the supernatural and occult, if they want to live in that, let them live for a while, but truth must be known. In this cyber age, in this age of communications,
absolutely,
people must know. People have a right, a democratic right to know the truth.
Yes.
And they should be responsible for their actions.
Mm-hmm.
The most important thing is we are making our life around an imaginary God.
Mm-hmm.
That is why we are escaping from our responsibilities. That should not happen.
Mm-hmm.
We should be responsible to the fellow human beings.
I think we've progressed further mentally than we have emotionally. It's very hard to break old habits and attitudes and ways of thinking. If you help other people become empowered, become more self-sufficient, there's less need for it. There's less need for it. If you enjoy, you know, doing something like that occasionally. But the more self-confidence, the more real strength, I think that's the answer. The empowerment of the individual is the answer, not telling somebody else what to think. As they become more self-sufficient and more...
Both Gora and Nirmal said there was a great deal of discussion about the importance of participation in the political process.
It is not enough if we vote in the elections. That is not enough. Along with the vote, we must control our governments effectively.
It's like hiring someone and not paying attention to the work they do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's very important. And that kind of change will come when we feel that humans are makers of their own systems.
Mm-hmm.
The systems are not made the constitutions or the government exist for the sake of the people. Mm-hmm. And the reverse is not true. People do not exist for the sake of the governments.
Well, we can't blame the people in the government.
Mm-hmm.
It's our job to put the right people and supervise them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And people must play the role as citizens. Effectively, they have to participate in the process of democracy. Mm-hmm. And they must give time and energies to improve the situation. The emphasis was given in the conference of the humanists on human rights.
Human rights.
And development. And there must be...
And development of what?
Development of women, development of...
Of people. And that's the education.
Yeah. Education, yes.
Oh, so that was really the focus. Mm-hmm.
And then we have to develop much more literature on this aspect. That is also very important.
Mm-hmm.
We have to, in order to educate the people, we need new avenues. The science and technology must be used effectively for human welfare.
Mm-hmm.
And in the cyber age, we have various methods. Electronic mail is there.
Ways.
And other types of communications are there. And mm-hmm. with that method, we can improve the knowledge and awareness among people.
Mm-hmm. Very quickly.
Mm-hmm. And we are living in a global village.
Mm-hmm.
Really, we are living in a global village, but with medieval mentality. That is why we have to change the mentality.
No, I think this. I think that mentally we're up to much more than we are emotionally.
Yeah.
I think mm-hmm. the problem is emotionally we haven't gotten past a lot of old attitudes, mm-hmm. a lot of old prejudices, a lot of old habits of mm-hmm. thinking. And
the electronic revolution brought us very close all over the world. We are living in a global village. But culturally, socially, economically, we are far apart still.
Mm-hmm.
And unless we make bridges of friendship between people of different nations,
mm-hmm.
there will not be much peace in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Peace of mind is important. At the same time, peace in the world also is very important.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why we have to emphasize more on human rights. We have to emphasize more on social justice. We have to emphasize more on liberation of women. Mm-hmm. We have to emphasize on rebuilding the societies on a just basis.
What about the caste system in India? Is that still very important?
Caste system is very old, and that is causing greater problem to women and men. That is why Ethics Center is fighting a battle against caste. We are promoting inter-caste marriages, inter-religion marriages,
right.
and asking people to be liberated from this outmoded caste system.
Gora, I was so impressed with your Atheist Center at Vijayawada. Your brother, Lavanan, has been here many times, and he's painted such glowing pictures. I thought maybe he exaggerated. But when we got there, I was amazed at what you've accomplished, because besides the whole center in Vijayawada, you have the clinics out in the countryside and a marvelous school for children and all of these, mm-hmm. it's an empire. You have an atheist empire there.
Yeah.
And I want you to talk a little bit about your parents, because your parents were really pioneers
mm-hmm.
in human rights and women's rights and so forth. So when did they start this movement?
Yes, I come from a family of atheists. My father and mother, father's name is Gora, and my mother's name is Saraswati. Both of them started Atheist Center in India. It is the first known Atheist Center in the world
mm-hmm.
that was started in the year 1940.
Yeah.
Even before that, for 25 years, they propagated atheism. And then finally in 1940, they started the center in a remote village in Andhra Pradesh of India. And since then, it has been the hub of activity. And Gora and Saraswati Gora were close associates of Mahatma Gandhi. They participated in the freedom struggle. They were in mm-hmm. the mainstream of the national struggles. They went to jail both in the freedom movement and also afterwards championing the cause of human rights and social justice. Gora and Saraswati Gora looked at atheism as a positive way of life.
We need to convince more people to choose rationality over blind faith and superstition.
We have to have another plan. We have to talk about another way to live or another way to operate.
Mere criticism, revolution also is not enough. Yes. We have to build alternatives.
Mm-hmm.
What society needs today on mm-hmm. the threshold of the 21st century is building of alternatives.
Mm-hmm.
We need alternative to dictatorships. We need alternative to any kind of authoritarianism. We need alternative to fundamentalism.
Mm-hmm.
All over the world, fundamentalism is growing because the alternative
but
is not
available. But we have to spell out that alternative.
Yeah, I think this is one observation which I made when I visited Vijayawada, that the center has done actual practical things the people.
Yes.
At the village
exactly.
level. That is what
exactly.
You actually do. You have programs.
Yeah. You chop wood and carry mm-hmm. water.
Yes. Yes, that's it.
Exactly.
And that is exactly what is needed on a global basis.
Right. Well, the other thing is there are some missing things in our education system as it stands. In other words, we don't have enough about teamwork. We have too much competitive
yes.
style mm-hmm. in our schools.
I think we have to move from competition to cooperation.
To cooperation and conflict resolution
yeah. mm-hmm.
and decision making and critical thinking. Those things are not emphasized or even taught in mm-hmm. some cases at all. So it was interesting that in law school, you know, how long you are in law school, I think there's only one semester on ethics.
Mm-hmm.
So there's kind of an imbalance there.
It's very important now, because what is happening is, in the name of improving the ethical standards in society, people want to bring back the religion. That is wrong, in mm-hmm. my opinion.
That's not the answer.
That is not the answer.
Personal religion empowerment and self-esteem is the
yeah,
answer.
Yes.
Exactly.
We have to increase the capacity of the people to think about others.
Right.
Social responsibility is the answer.
Yes, yes.
And any amount of religion.
Well, they have to think of the larger family.
Mm. Yeah.
It's beyond the blood relatives, you know, it's the whole family, it's the whole human family. Yeah. We have to think in terms of being part of a larger family, the whole society, the whole family of humanity. It's one world interdependent. And we all have a responsibility to each other as well as ourselves.
We hope you have found this program intellectually stimulating and that you will continue to investigate the ideas raised here. To connect with other like-minded individuals, please contact any of the dozens of free thought organizations, such as the American Humanist Association, American Atheists, the Center for Inquiry, and Atheists United. You may also email the producer directly via leebaker27@gmail.com. This program has been distributed through the courtesy of Atheists United.